Hello and welcome to our panel discussion on examining race and institutionalized disadvantage in our community. I want to take a moment to share with our viewers that this program is being recorded for future viewing. If you would like to submit any questions to our panel, you may do so by emailing Representative Christina Sappey. Her email address is repsappey@pahouse.net. Again, that's R-E-P-S-A-P-P-E-Y at pahouse.net. And now I'm going to turn it over to Representative Sappey for a brief introduction.
Good evening. I'm State Representative Christina Sappey in the 158th Legislative District, which includes the southern part of West Goshen, East Bradford, West Bradford, Newland Township, New Garden Township, East Marlboro, West Marlboro, and the borough of Avondale. I'm really pleased that you've joined us this evening to have this important conversation about race, racism, and what we can possibly do about it in our district, and how do we each start to change the way we think about each other and move forward. So I'm going to just start real quickly with a story. I think, you know, I was raised in a family that attended church, and my mother was a Sunday school teacher. And when I was a very small child, we got a call late one Sunday evening from some parents of a young man that was in my mother's Sunday school class. And my mother hung up the phone and she was in tears. And I was around 4 or 5 years old. I was a very small child. And she tried to share this story with me that the little boy's parents had asked a lot of questions about another child that had been in the Sunday school classroom. And they were very upset to find out that this person was an Asian American child, and they were not going to attend our church anymore. And my mother could not really wrap her head around leaving a congregation and people you know and love and worship with based on race. And so I think that was my very first lesson into, inclusion and tolerance and respect for others. But as I was talking with some friends just a few moments ago, I realized, you know, over the course of my lifespan, we've gone from that to when you're walking down the street, you know, holding your purse, being advised to hold your purse a little bit closer to your body. And some of the behaviors that were taught over time just really counter that original teaching. And I'm struck over and over again by the kindness, the generosity, and the love in this district. And I think that's what really motivated me tonight to want to have this conversation, is I've never known a people that were so generous with their time and their resources. And I think it's very important for us in this district, where we are 97% white and one of the top three income per capita districts in the entire Commonwealth, to come together to have a conversation about where do we go now and how do we change the way things are, because we have to start to have these conversations. We've been talking about it my entire life, and yet here we are today. So I'm very pleased to have a panel with us. Two of my colleagues from the House were supposed to join us this evening, Representative Morgan Cephas and Representative Malcolm Kenyatta. And they were, I'm disappointed they aren't able to be with us, but I completely understand and support them. They are very busy in Harrisburg doing work with the Legislative Black Caucus this evening. So we will bring them in again at some point in the future to have a follow-up conversation. But this evening, I have Dr. Joan Duvall-Flynn, a wonderful woman that I've known for a long time. Joan and I have done a lot of work on trauma-informed education together. Joan is also president of the NAACP media branch. And I also have Pastor Caroline Cupp from the First Presbyterian Church of Westchester. And so we will be, having a conversation based on the questions that are submitted to us. And I'm looking forward to a great beginning dialogue with both of you. And I'm going to turn it over to Joan to introduce herself.
Good evening. State Rep, I cannot thank you enough for including me in this conversation. I'm humbled by your contact and your invitation. I'm deeply committed to your success as a legislator, because you have mentored us as we worked on trauma-informed education and just been just a guiding light. And to push that bill through was a blessing to the Commonwealth, and I appreciate you very much. I'm happy to meet you, Reverend Cup. Nice to be on the panel with you. My remarks, if I should give them now, shall I start this conversation?
Sure.
Okay. I was so proud that State Representative Sappey had the courage to start a courageous conversation about institutionalized disadvantage in our community. I looked at it from a social science perspective, and the process for creating an institutionalized disadvantaged group or groups is worldwide. It is historic in nature. It has happened every place on the planet Earth. And the social scientists have examined the process that creates such a system. And that system is specific and it is detailed in how it is structured. So we begin when a power dominant force imposes themselves upon a society of those who are going to become the oppressed people under that power domination. They impose themselves. So how did that happen with this country? If you just recall history, it started with moving into Africa, the West Africa coast, and imposing force and grabbing people and bringing them across the ocean. At the same time, the imposition of force against the indigenous people of this country as land was taken and the people were systematically organized to move further and further toward the West. So that is the first step, forcing and imposing power over a group. The second step is subjugation in various forms of labor. And this subjugation greatly restricts the physical and social mobility of the targeted group and restricts its participation in the political process. So just recalling American history, once slavery was formalized and written into law as a permanent condition of servitude, then people who were subjected, the people of African blood, could not move around freely. They had to have a letter of permission. They had to have papers that identified where they belonged. And that's the example. And it happened with the Native Americans. Once they reserved their lands, they were not free to move around either. The third thing that happens is a cultural policy that constrains, transforms, or destroys the original values, orientations, and ways of life for the targeted group. So when people of African blood were brought here, they could not use their native language. They could not use the drums, which was a communication tool for them. With the Native Americans, there was an attempt to socialize them into white value system. And so they were taken from, the children were taken and put in specific schools. And that's an example of how the transformation, the destruction of the original values occurs. The next step is the experience of being managed and manipulated by outsiders in terms of ethnic status. The lives of the targeted group tend to be administered and by representatives of the dominant political group and by law. And you know that when the 4 million people of African blood were released into the economic mainstream of the United States, that they could not find work. They were managed, and the Jim Crow laws began to be written. As the federal legislation was passed to create citizenship and to create the right to vote, the backlash by the power dominant group was to also write state laws that impeded the political engagement. It impeded the economic ability of these people. So under slavery, people of African blood could not enter into a legal contract. Hence, they could not actually marry under the laws of this country. They could not leave property to their offspring. They were forbidden to learn to read and write. And there was no consequence actually for killing a person of African blood. And we have seen history and we know how these things have looked as they played out. So what fuels and enables this process, which it's insidious, it happens incrementally, is the underlying racist ideology, which dehumanizes the target group and defines the dominant group as distinct and superior. And so 300 years ago, you know, a law was written in Virginia that created the social construct white. And in that law, access was given to economic capacity and to political capacity. At the same time, it was restricted from the category that was created called perpetual slavery. So it's insidiously built. It's and the process somehow or other infuses itself into the minds of all the citizens. The eugenics movement, which targeted those who were seen as unfit for society, and this included the poor, the disabled, the mentally ill, and specific communities of color. It was a nationwide movement. The scientists were measuring people's skulls and, you know, talking about the degenerative nature of folk of color. The eugenicist sterilization initiatives were directed toward women identified as African American, Hispanic, or Native American. And so this just kept moving. It was like a stream flowing and gathering momentum as it flowed. And as you know, the Grand Canyon was dug by a river that constantly flowed. And here we are today in a society where we have institutionalized disadvantage. So I'll stop there and we'll talk more as other panelists have shared and as the questions come in.
Thank you so much, Dr. Flynn. And now I'm gonna just move over to Reverend Cupp to introduce herself and sort of tell us a little bit about, as a church leader, how is the faith community addressing some of these issues?
Pastor Cupp, I believe you're muted.
I will unmute myself.
Oh, there you go, there you go. That.
Representative Sappey, thank you so much for inviting me to be part of this incredibly important conversation. And Dr. Duvall-Flynn, it's an honor to be on this panel with you. As a pastor, I'm a pastor at a Presbyterian church in Westchester, and I will say I am certainly not an expert when it comes to race, when it comes to the historical subjugation of our brothers and sisters of color. But I'm among those who are seeking to respond with wisdom and sensitivity to the crisis that our neighbors have been going through for centuries. And what has risen up in the past few weeks is an inescapable part of our national dialogue. And so one might ask, where is the faith community in all this? And while I represent just one very small aspect of this of the broader faith community, I can talk a little bit about some of the work that we're doing. Mm-hmm. One of the contributions that faith communities have across the board in times like this is giving space and language for lament and for confession. And as Dr. Duvall-Flynn just so eloquently shared, there is much to lament and much to confess. An American civic culture broadly doesn't have a lot of robust tradition or practice around naming those places that where we've hurt each other either historically or today. And we'd probably all agree that when anybody seeks to do that, there can be a lot of defensiveness and attempt whenever anybody tries to do that in a meaningful way. But across communities of faith, not only Christian, but Jewish and Muslim, there's this many centuries, millennia long tradition of talking about the ways that we hurt each other. Like many other congregations, First Presbyterian begins each worship service with a confession of sin, naming those places where we and the systems of which we're a part act poorly and not in the way that we believe are intended. And the important thing about this is that there is an assumption of brokenness, that part of the human condition is being imperfect. And so for everybody that says, wait a minute, that happened so long ago. Why am I confessing something? Why am I lamenting something that happened forever ago? Or that I'm not one of those people. The faith community would say, hey, we're all some of those people. We all have areas in our lives that are broken and that are sinful. And that's part of our makeup, is to address those things. Confession allows us to name those places where we're in the wrong, either individually as part of a group, and to bring them to our awareness so that we can address them. But it doesn't end there. Confession is followed by a statement of forgiveness, or assurance in God's forgiveness. And in my tradition, forgiveness is not like a free pass. It's not, okay, wipe my hands of that, we're all done, now we just get to go back. It's the first part of the next step, which is an invitation to a new way of living. And people of faith ask for divine assistance in living in that new way, a more just way and a more peaceful way. Faith communities can also remind ourselves and our neighbors that there is no peace without justice. I see a lot of language, as I'm sure all of you do, around, oh, this is a peaceful protest. This is a, I wish we could really address what Dr. King would do with, which was so peaceful. And I think what we have to remember is that peace is not an absence of conflict. Peace is not being nice. Peace is what results from a community that does the hard work of building a society around principles of justice. We can't just slap a name peace on it and say that it's peace. And justice building at its heart is uncomfortable work. It's uncomfortable because it's disrupting something. It's causing something to shift. And as humans, we tend to not like shifting, particularly when people like me are in positions of tremendous privilege and power. And we forget, I think, sometimes when we're addressing, talking about Dr. King, that he, during his lifetime, made people enormously uncomfortable. He was not a popular figure. The things that he did were radical. And to change the status quo, people are going to get upset. And one thing that I try to remind myself is that if no one's uncomfortable, then we're probably not doing meaningful work. Mm-hmm. We also are asked as communities of faith to do something that the Presbyterian Church calls unmasking idolatry. And one, in any human situation, in any human institution, whether it's politics, whether it's law enforcement, certainly religious institutions, we are all going to be imperfect because these institutions are crafted by human individuals. But when we find ourselves slipping into a space where we're not holding those human institutions, either others or the ones that we ourselves are a part of, when we're not holding those accountable for human failings, then we know that we've begun to engage in idolatry. And the task of the church is to call all of those idols into question and to make sure that as we are outraged as people, that our outrage is directed in the right place. So if people are saying, oh my gosh, we're outraged at the rioting, at what's going on, to say, is that being outraged in sort of the right way? Are we also outraged about the destruction of human life, about the historical and contemporary looting that has gone on in African American communities and communities of color? Are we outraged in the right ways, I would say? And finally, I think that communities of faith can act as way stations for those who are justice seekers and peacemakers in our society. Dr. Duvall-Flynn would probably know much, much better than I that the work of justice building is long and tough, and it's often demoralizing, and it doesn't resolve quickly. It's not like, okay, we can now move on to something else. But faith groups are places where people can join together to be fed for this work, through worship and through singing and through storytelling, through education, building each other up, asking questions. And it's a place where we can hold that pain together and where we can care for each other along this long road. So that concludes my this part of my remarks.
Well, I want to thank our panelists for joining us this evening. And before we start taking questions from those at home, I wanted to quickly remind those watching that your questions can be submitted to repsappey@pahouse.net. Again, that's repsappey@pahouse.net. And I wanted to start with a little bit of a basic question before we do start going into the questions that we do have from folks at home. And that is, what is racism today? And more importantly, what does it look like? What does it look like?
I would respond in part to that, not that I have a final definition, but we find racism embedded in our law. If we fail to fund all schools equally, and we do the research and find out that the schools that got shortcut and still don't have the resources to educate children are all Black and brown schools, then that is a quiet way that the opinions that there are some people who are more deserving than others gets perpetuated. And the work against this is continuous and it's recursive. We think back to the Brown decision in the 54-55, but that work was started in the 20s. And the NAACP that carried that piece worked on it for a few decades before it got to court. We are right back now having the same discussions about how essential it is that all people have access to an adequate education that will equip them for contemporary society. Same thing with voting. The first struggle for minorities to have the vote, Black men to have the vote, was during Reconstruction, when finally the vote was given to Black males. That left out women. Then the recursive work of fighting for the vote was done by women, and they suffered terribly. They were divorced, they were put in insane asylums, they were put in prison, they were beaten. And it's all because folk who hold power really hold on to it as long as they can. And a lot of what we go through with identifying certain groups by color, by religious tradition, by ethnicity, is the war to maintain power and wealth. If you can identify this group and marginalize them, then it is easier for the power dominant group to maintain wealth and power. So we look at always having to sort out what is going on to try to impede people from voting. Mm-hmm. You know, and right now, it's a fight against mail-in ballots. But Pennsylvania had to go through the court against voter ID. And so it's recursive. You make some progress, then the power dominant group looks to see if that's going to interfere with their power and wealth, and they go to work against your progress. So, and in this country, it is easy to identify people by skin color. And so the power dominant group marginalizes folk by skin color. There's also other subtle marginalization by economic status and such. But the one that incites people to protest is usually a tremendous inhumane act against someone, and that victim is usually a person of color. So I'll stop there.
Caroline, do you want to add to that? Or would you like to?
I think that the Reverend is muted again.
Yep.
Yeah, I believe you're, yep, there you go.
I need to stop taking off my mute. So I think that the only thing I would add is this, what I observe at times is people, you know, especially white Americans, say when something is brought up, an issue like the horrific murder of George Floyd, or other systems of terrible inequity, it's yes, but. So we need police, you know, police reform, but when are we going to address black and black crime? We need to fund the education system, but when will people start paying their property taxes? And that kind of conversation to me sounds like something where we're expecting a group of our fellow citizens to somehow earn human rights. That it's, you must earn the right not to be brutalized by the police. You must earn the right to receive a decent education, decent healthcare, and we're gonna watch your behavior until you earn it. And to me, there's something so horrifying about that type of engagement and that type of dialogue. Now, I think that there's so many complex issues and so many things that that we, you know, so many layers to everything. I don't want to oversimplify it, but when we construct a when we say that human rights are sort of a barter system, there's something to me that is so deeply sad about that. And to me, that captures a lot of the undercurrent of racism.
If I could share, you bring up some things that are so embedded in racist conversation. And I think it's because people really don't know the history of this country and how law was used to create this disadvantaged group. And so if we look at the issue of school funding and property taxes, most people don't know and understand that after World War II, when the federal government created the Federal Housing Commission and they were building, the federal government was actually building the infrastructure for suburbia. But at these construction sites, there were huge signs that said, no Negroes or Jews. And so people of color were relegated to what the term ghettos, or places where the property value was low. And there has never been enough property value money or funding to really have strong, well-resourced schools. I live in a community where we don't have a problem with property tax. We have tennis courts and a natatorium and anything the children could possibly benefit from. And a lot of education has to do with the intangibles that surround the curriculum. How you internalize a sense of well-being and safety and privilege. One instance is, if you have a tennis team and you have beautiful tennis courts, you internalize that. That's an intangible value that the kids in my school district, or the one where I pay taxes, are benefits of. It's one of their benefits, I'm sorry. And the other thing, you say black on black crime, you know, people do bring that up. And that takes us back to the work that Representative Sappey and I did for so many years. Trauma hurt people. And the whole research and discussion now on how these historic intergenerational traumas have led us to where we are now, where hurt people. Now, it's not only in the black community, but in the institutionalization of this country, the news would carry and use the front page of the newspaper to position pictures in such a way that they called out this criminalized black person. You know, it would be above the fold on the front page. And just very subtle ways. During the eugenics movement, the whole discussion about the criminalization of black people, where they were measuring their skulls and trying to prove that if you had a certain skull form and a certain measurement of your skull, that you were going to be a criminal. It's just been, as I say, like the Colorado River, flowing and digging, one approach after the other to marginalize certain groups of people. So move forward to today, when people who have enough, have all they need, have a good retirement system, have a good education. They don't know these things, but what they have heard are the ongoing discussions and the ongoing stereotypes. And even if you look back to Thomas Jefferson's Notes on Virginia and read how he described people of African blood, you will cry. It is so cruel. And those mindsets, you know, they've just been passed on intergenerationally. And so folk today don't know where they came from, but it is what they have interpolated by the greater society and how they grew up in the house where those thoughts abounded. So that's my reaction to those two powerful recognitions, Reverend Paul.
Well, for those of you just joining into this discussion, we are about halfway through our panel discussion on examining race and institutionalized disadvantage in our community. And a reminder, if you would like to submit any questions to our panel, you may do so by emailing Representative Christina Sappey, and her email address is repsappey@pahouse.net. Again, that's R-E-P-S-A-P-P-E-Y at pahouse.net. Our next question, we're going to start getting into the questions that we've received from viewers at home. David from East Bradford would like to know if you could provide specific examples of institutionalized racism.
I'm going to defer to Joan and to Caroline. I know that, you know, there are so many systems, you know, where this is ingrained, and it's, you know, it's education, it's access to healthcare, access to housing. You know, one of the conversations I had as a child, you know, and as a young woman with my late father was, you know, the concept of the level playing field. And I think, you know, both of you have touched on that in the things that you've just spoken about. But, you know, having two committed loving parents in your home is an advantage, and it's, you know, nothing to feel guilty about. It's something to rejoice in. But, you know, having a roof over your head, having food security. We have, even here in Chester County, I think a lot of us understand, you know, that how busy we are at the food bank. We have tremendous food insecurity here in Chester County. When you go to school in the morning and you're hungry, you can't stay awake, you can't learn. So, you know, these types of institutionalized disadvantages, you know, just permeate an entire lifespan. So, but again, that's a very broad overview. I'm going to let the two of you touch on what you see and what you experience.
Well, how things get institutionalized is through law and practice. So the practice of refusing to sell a home to a person of color in a certain neighborhood was supported by the fact that there were no consequences. And as I said, initially when the suburbs were built, Jewish people and Negroes, as they were called at the time, could not purchase a home in the suburbs there, where those signs abounded. They could not get a loan from the Federal Housing Commission. They could not benefit and gain access to the things that the government put in place to stabilize and build a strong middle class. They could not get business. Think of insurance. So it's called redlining. If I live in a certain area, my car insurance costs a great deal more, and the kind of car insurance I can expect to purchase is different because of where I live. And yet I lived where I lived because I couldn't live anyplace else. So the institutionalization of it is multidimensional. It's very complex. If I apply for a job because I have the training and qualifications, but because of the color of my skin, it's okay for people to push aside my application. That's institutionalized because there were no consequences. It could be done because of feelings of superiority and the assumption that people with dark skin could not be intelligent. And this goes back to Thomas Jefferson's Notes on Virginia, when Phyllis Wheatley wrote her poetry and people were asking Thomas Jefferson if he had read it. His response was, no. Well, what could possibly come out of a black mind that would be worthy of any white attention? And these institutionalized attitudes that are intergenerational and subtly today, just take something as simple as the PTA or the PTO, which is mainly a group of white mothers, and they get social capital for being there and holding office. And it is not an uncommon experience if a minority person goes into the group for them to be marginalized. This I saw as I taught for 40 years. So to be marginalized and their ideas don't quite get the attention a good idea would get until it is co-signed by or brought up by someone from the power dominant group. In business, in professional life, same thing. These thoughts that ideas that come from dark-skinned people couldn't possibly measure up in quality. And it's institutionalized. If you look at, as you brought up, medical care, the assumption that is not uncommon in the medical field that people of darker skin don't feel pain to the same degree that people from the power dominant group do. And so they don't get the medications sometimes that they need to relieve their pain. Mm-hmm. And it's institutionalized. It's right.
Can we get another? We just want to make sure people, we have enough time to answer a lot of these other questions that may be coming in. But thank you so much, Joan. The great examples.
Absolutely. Another question that we were submitted here is from Bob from East Marlborough. And he would like to know, how would you address partisan gerrymandering and how that contributes to institutionalized racial disadvantage?
That's a great question. I'll take a stab at that one. You know, Joan alluded to this earlier in some of her remarks, but, you know, we legislators basically draw their own districts every 10 years after the census is done, and they, you know, kind of bargain, and we stick people based on demographics and voter registration in these crazy shaped districts. And that really does perpetuate, I think, racism here, frankly, and we definitely need to reform the way we redistrict. And I'm going to put a plug in here right now. I don't know if it's going to happen this June because we're only in for, five more days this month, and maybe in the fall, I don't know. But we really need an independent redistricting commission to examine how we redistrict and, you know, where these lines get drawn, because I'm sure if you've looked at, you know, the district of the 158th, you know, starting up in West Goshen and going all the way down to Avondale, you know, it didn't look like that 20 years ago. And, you know, we just really carve people out based on, you know, a lot of socioeconomic and, you know, racial situations. And so we need to make that change. I think that it definitely fuels it. And I don't, Joan and Caroline, I don't know if you want to add to that. Okay.
Go ahead, Rev. It diminishes the power of the individual vote.
Right.
And districts are carved out so that certain legislators know they're going to be reelected. And if there are only a few minorities caught up in there, then their vote doesn't speak for the needs and values that they represent.
Mm-hmm. Very true. Very true. We have another question here from Jamie from Westchester. For someone in the community like myself who just doesn't want to protest but do something, what would you suggest? How can we as residents get involved?
That is a wonderful question, and I'm going to definitely let Caroline touch on that in a moment also. But I can say, have these difficult conversations. I read the most wonderful piece on Medium this morning, written by a young man, and you know, who just, you know, drew a beautiful picture of what it's like to be young right now. And I think you need to be having these difficult conversations with people that don't think like you, in a loving way. It's okay to disagree. We have to be okay with disagreeing with each other on some of this, but we have to also make these systemic changes that have been needed for centuries here in America. So if you're not going to go out and join a protest, that's completely fine. I think looking for other avenues, you know, here online, finding, you know, putting a group together to have a conversation is very important. And you know, that's my feedback. But Caroline, what would you have to say?
Sure. So I would agree with everything that you said. Mm-hmm. In addition, I would say, so certainly vote not only in your own best interest, but in the best interest of your neighbors who may not look like you. Give money. So, you know, we sometimes say, oh, I don't want to just give money, but giving money to Black-led organizations like the NAACP. There's many, the Thurgood Marshall Association for HBCUs, all of these things. There's a million lists of them online. But give your money to raise up that next generation. And educate yourself. So even if you're not out there protesting, there is so much good content, historical and contemporary, written by people of color for a broad audience. And so get yourself some information. And so all of those are ways that you can contribute to this conversation without being out there marching.
And if I could just say, learn the true history of this country and learn how these laws have systematically created this system.
All right, our next question is Marilyn from Newlyn. What can be done to put more money into education, especially education for African American students?
Joan's going to be able to chime in here with me, and I can. We've been having this fight for a long time, and we fund public education in Pennsylvania with our property taxes, as we've discussed earlier, and that is based on, you know, home assessments. And so that also means that there's not an equal amount of funding flowing through all of our 500 school districts here in Pennsylvania. So how do we do that? Well, we've passed a basic education funding formula that would flow equitably through all of our school districts. We have not implemented it. And for the one reason being that some of our more affluent school districts will lose a portion of their funding in order to make up for some of the inequities across the board. But, you know, we have schools in our urban centers and in our rural parts of Pennsylvania, which are many, where the schools are crumbling. There's asbestos, there's lead in the water. And, you know, it's an unsafe and physical environment, and it's definitely an unfit education. It's a hard way to start when you don't have the technology. You're at a serious disadvantage compared to the school districts here in Chester County. So, you know, we we do very well here. There are five school districts that touch the 158th legislative district, but and they all do a phenomenal job. We're very, very fortunate, but some of them could possibly lose some funding when we pass our funding through that basic education funding formula. So we recognize that, you know, funding equitably is important, but actually doing it is a problem. And it's been several years now since we passed it and are not using it. So I'll let Joan touch on that because she's very close to this issue.
Thank you. All that you've said is true, and pushing for having all funds flow through the formula is the way to get more money to the underfunded schools. Education foundations in these wealthy districts, you know, they will catch up anything that is lost from state funding to that school. They have money, they have affluent people. Those children are not going to suffer, ever. Failing to fully fund all schools causes every person in the Commonwealth to suffer eventually, because we're on this boat together. And if it sinks, we're all going down with the ship. You cannot have an uneducated population and have a strong economic community. The children, they are ill. Taxpayers have to catch the consequences of that in hospital funding and emergency room visits. And it's just a no-win situation to hold on to a few pennies that are going to cost you millions of dollars.
All right. Well, while we are still talking about education here, Carol has a question for us. What can we do to ensure that our education includes informed curriculum, not always history and literature and civics from the white perspective, but textbooks and course materials that reflect an informed curriculum outside of that perspective?
Well, the curriculum standards are formed by the Pennsylvania Department of Education. And so, you know, our school districts have to design their curriculum to meet those standards that the state has required. So, you know, that is something that we can, the legislature could require the Department of Education to include.
It's important also to just accept the reality that the power dominant group tells history and their story their way. From their perspective, they're just telling their story. So in order to expand that curriculum, it will take a forced declaration that this certain things need to be included. And forced declaration is, of course, a law. So that is the approach. And you go to your school board, you call your state representatives, you let folk know that these are your values and this is what you believe society needs, and that's how you get it.
Even if you feel like this is an urgent conversation, as I do, it needs to happen now, I would say, parents, there's so many good ways to introduce a broader education than the often wonderful education that your teachers are giving by reading, museums, experiences, conversations. So if you do your own supplemental curriculum, it's certainly not ideal, but it can happen today.
Right. That's a very good point, Caroline. It's just, that is very important. It's also, though, challenging, I think, in places where parents have one or two jobs or are single parents to do some of that, but the reading and there are a lot of community organizations that are trying to support young parents in parenting and to include some of those things. So I think that's true. Going through the legislature is a long process because we, you know, have to do a task force to study the situation, and then we issue a report, and then the legislature makes recommendations, and then whatever governor's administration is in office has to decide whether or not to act on that or not. So, it, as you point out, it's a long process.
All right, well, Pamela from Westchester would like to know, we hear that we should be anti-racism. What does this look like when implemented?
Well, I would love to tackle that.
There you go, girl. Have it.
Because of what we're seeing in the streets today in the demographics of the protesters. And I'm thinking about it this way. What we're seeing is faith, hope, and charity. There is faith that if they speak up against what is harming society, that if they call it to the front and say, these are not our values and we don't want to be a nation like this, they have then the hope that things will change. And I believe they're going to change because of the demographics of the protesters. There is no ethnic group known to mankind that is not engaged in peaceful protest in this country right now. And so what are they working for? And this, they're working for an anti-racist society, an anti-hate society. So they want people to be treated reasonably, be treated with human respect and kindness, and to be treated fairly. And when we are all living in relationship with each other in those ways, there will not be racism.
Can I add one thing as well? When I hear anti-racist, I think also of a very active, not only external struggle of changing these systems of which we're a part, but also a commitment to a lot of internal work. None of us, you know, the air we breathe is racist air in so many ways because of these systems. And to say, well, I'm not affected by that, it's not possible. None of us cannot be infected by it. But what we can do is go back to those of, you know, sort of confession. Hey, where is my worldview too narrow? Where am I acting not out of the best part of my ideals, but out of these parts of myself that if I looked at them closely, I don't really like. And so to be anti-racist means to do that hard work of educating oneself, of consuming good content about history and contemporary issues, of asking yourself those hard questions about, you know, how diverse is my social circle? Because those internal changes can affect external changes as well.
And we do only have about 5 minutes left. So I do want to get to probably one more question, and then we'll kind of get to all of your closing thoughts and final statements. But our final question I want to leave us with is from Robin from West Bradford, and they would like to know what efforts are already underway and what else is coming that would help eliminate Pennsylvania's severe problems with mass incarceration.
I can tell you that, you know, I mentioned early on that we've done, our Legislative Black Caucus has done a lot of work on this in the House, and they have put together a list of recommendations, and the governor committed to working on this late last week by executive order. So we are working very hard. We have several pieces of legislation that address criminal justice reform and also tackle a lot of, again, these systemic issues of educational inequality. We talk about environmental injustice. That's something I don't think we've touched on here tonight, but if you think about where our major polluters are, they're in areas where people are, you know, lower income and have racial, you know, diversity, unfortunately. So there's a lot of different pieces of legislation in Harrisburg currently that would address these things. And I think we're at a point now of extreme frustration because these pieces of legislation do not move. They do not move out of committee. If they move out of the committee, if the committee actually votes them to the floor, they never make it to the schedule. And I think we're seeing the breaking point with this. it's time for us to run this legislation. If this legislation fails on the floor and in the House and the Senate, so be it. But at least give it the opportunity to be heard. And that has not happened in my term, and it has not happened for a long time. And it's time to change that. So how we operate in the House to move and consider legislation is incredibly important to addressing the issues you're raising.
All right, well, we are coming to a close here, and with us coming to a close, I want to thank our friends at home for participating. We apologize to anyone we could not get to, but please stay tuned to Representative Sappey's Facebook and social media. We are working on a follow-up discussion as well. And I want to thank our guests again for joining us this evening, Pastor Caroline Cupp, Dr. Joan Duvall-Flynn, and Representative Christina Sappey. Thank you all for joining us tonight. With that, I'm going to give you all a minute or two to just give us your final thoughts before we log off for the night. Pastor Caroline Cupp, we'll start with you. Final thoughts.
Sure. So again, thank you so much for having this conversation and inviting me to be a part of it. I think I would just say, you know, to be an ally is not to be perfect. If you're nervous about how to start these conversations, I try to remember, okay, I might be nervous, I might be afraid, but people of color are nervous and afraid all the time. Right. So instead of that nervousness being a barrier, treat it as an invitation to step into a new way of being in connection to somebody else. And also remembering, especially for my brothers and sisters who share my white skin, that this is not either or. The justice for our brothers and sisters of color is something that will help all of us. As Dr. Duvall-Flynn so beautifully shared, when we fund education equitably, when we have a better and more just society, that's not a loss for some of us. That's a gain for all of us. And just a reminder again that as we seek to be allies, if we are feeling pretty good about this, that's great. But if we're only feeling good about this, then we're probably not going as far as we should. Because again, real change is change that is probably going to push our boundaries, going to push us to the edge of what feels safe or comfortable. And when we're in that spot, we're probably on the right track.
Totally agree.
Dr. Joan Duvall-Flynn, your final thoughts?
My final thoughts are this. I am so proud to be in the company of courageous women like Pastor Cook. I say your name wrong, but you know who I mean. State Rep Sappey. State Representative Sappey, it took a lot of courage to say to the public, let's have this conversation. And I would say to your constituents that I'm encouraged that public servants such as yourself are in the Pennsylvania State Legislature, in the State Assembly. I hope that a critical mass of persons with your values and your courage are elected in the next cycle, because you will change the world simply because your value system is in the right place and your courage is in place. And I'm just delighted that you thought to call and invite me to participate in this. And I hope that some of the things that were on my mind to share have added to the understanding of your constituents. And I hope they vote you in until you tell them you don't want to vote.
And on that note, Representative Sappey, final thoughts from you as well?
Well, thank you both so much, or thank you all so much for joining us this evening for this, you know, what I hope will be the first of many conversations together. This has just been an incredibly challenging year. And, you know, we've all seen the jokes about 2020 and when does it end? But I think we're in a moment. We are really in a very important moment in history. And I think as Joan talked about, seeing, you know, all of the different people at our peaceful protests here locally and, you know, abroad, overseas, seeing how the entire world is just clamoring for change is very, very powerful. And that's, you know, empowered me in my role to want to have this conversation. But, you know, knowing both of you women as leaders, thought leaders in our area, I'm so appreciative of your being here. And I hope you'll continue to encourage others to do the personal work, because that's the hard stuff. That's the really hard stuff for us. And I see it all the time, to, you know, understand your vulnerabilities and your insecurities and say, you know, why do I feel this way? And why do I behave this way? And to get over that defensiveness and move forward is so empowering. And, you know, again, I thank you so much for being with us this evening. And for the constituents in the area that have joined us, I appreciate your taking the time, and stay tuned. We're going to keep doing this. Thank you all.
Well, thank you again to our panel. Thank you to all the viewers at home for being involved. We know that these discussions are never easy, but we hope that you will continue to have these hard talks with your families, friends, and loved ones, so that we will one day be a nation that judges based on character and not the color of our skin. With that, stay safe and enjoy the rest of your night. Thank you.
Thank you.